देखिए
गुड मॉर्निंग सर।
गुड इवनिंग, गुड मॉर्निंग नथी,
सॉरी सर।
कसे हम सॉरी।
गुड इवनिंग मैम।
गुड इवनिंग।
आज तो प्रेजेंस पूरवानी इच्छा छे मारी।
गुड आइडिया।
એટલે જેટલા આવે છે બધાને પૂછીશું વારાફરતી। I will ask them to unmute there whenever it needed, I feel so. આઈ થિંક અમારે લેપ્રોટોમી ચાલે છે એટલે થોડા ત્યાં લાગે છે। શ્વેતા, જુલી અને ફર્સ્ટ યર કૌસ્તુભ, લેપ્રોટોમી ચાલુ થઈ? યુ ડોન્ટ નો
અત્યારે લીધું।
પૃથ્વી?
યસ સર।
હા, લેપ્રોટોમી ચાલુ થઈ?
યસ સર, પેશન્ટ ટેબલ પર લીધું છે।
ઓકે, ગુડ, સ્ટાર્ટ કરીએ હવે। ઓકે
ઓકે,
કૌસ્તુભ સ્ટાર્ટ।
ગુડ ઇવનિંગ એવરીવન, માય ટોપિક ફોર ટુડેઝ પ્રેઝન્ટેશન ઇઝ સર્જિકલ ઓડિટ ઓન અ કેસ ઓફ એડ્રેનોકોર્ટિકલ કાર્સિનોમા।
Kaustubh, what is meaning of audit?
Sir, it is going back and evaluating what we have done and what could have been done in throughout pre-operative, operative or post-operative course of this patient.
Okay. So it is the re-evaluating the what we have done. This is not a theory lecture. That I am not interested what are the types of adrenal carcinoma, what are the types of this. What I will be interested in, how patient presented and what we did, and if the similar patient comes again, what we can do, right? And what better we could have done. That's the point of audit. And it is for everybody will understand, if such patient comes, this is the line of management. That's what we are interested. So starting from clinical examination, ultrasonography, any special investigation and management. So everywhere you should be asking the question, not deciding that we have done this, we have done, then the lecture will be over in 5 minutes. Okay, start.
Sir, patient presented to us with pain in OPD with pain in left hypochondrium region.
What was the age of patient? Male patient, female patient? This is a very important point you should understand. Clinical presentation, age is an important point. Don't forget that. Right? So what was the patient? Was a male of?
50-year-old male patient, sir.
Mm-hmm.
50-year-old male patient presented to OPD with complaint of pain in left hypochondrium region and lumbar region since past 2 months. Pain was dull aching in nature, diffuse and non-radiating. Lump was palpable and noticeable to the patient in left hypochondrium since past 2 months. It did not increase in size since when it was first noticed by the patient. There is no history of nausea, vomiting, constipation, burning micturition or change in color of urine. It was associated with headache, which was dull aching type. Since
why, Kaustubh, what do you mean by no change in color of urine?
Sir, change in color of urine, I wanted to ask about hematuria.
So why don't you say no hematuria?
Yes.
Why it is important?
Sir, since the location of
Yes. Yes. So hematuria. Suppose patients have got yellow color urine. Right. Similarly, another important history which should have been added is a fever. Why history of fever is important in this case?
Sir, in left hypochondrium region, the splenomegaly.
Yes, very good. So patient can have a chronic fever because at present you don't know what is the lung.
Yes.
You understand? You are always, the problem with all of us is we always see report first and then set our clinical history. You don't know, patient has a lump. Remember, renal lump or a suprarenal lumps are usually not palpable. That should be kept in mind. The palpable lumps are in a left hypochondrium are mainly arising from spleen, left lobe of liver, sometimes stomach and transverse colon or the splenic flexor. And renal lump, suprarenal lump, which becomes palpable is rarest, right? Even renal lumps are palpable differently, not in a left hypochondrium. Understand this point. So when patient, you can judge that patient is having a lump in left hypochondrium, think of spleen or similar condition first. So history of fever, hematuria, these are the important history you will ask. What other important history in such area you will ask? Which you have already written.
Sir, vomiting?
Yes. No, not vomiting. Next, headache. Okay. Why the patient was having headache? What is meaning of that? Importance of that?
Sir, if it is a suprarenal mass and in past history, patient already says that he is known case of hypertension. If he is having headache, it could be pheochromocytoma.
So what should be the way to present it?
Only
remember, this is a problem. Only headache has no value. Understand this point. So what will be the patient's symptoms? That is the presenting symptoms which may suggest that patient has a pheochromocytoma. Remember, headache is not the important symptoms on its own. Headache is very common. Most of the patient has headache. Similarly, a known case of hypertension is not that important. Because a many patient of suprarenal will have a anyway hypertensive. So what is important? What history you will go back and ask in this patient?
Sir, we should ask for palpitation and diaphoresis.
So symptoms of paroxysmal hypertension. What are those symptoms?
Sir, intermittent palpitation, diaphoresis.
You are talking about symptoms of hypertension.
What we are talking paroxysmal.
Paroxysmal hypertension.
Sir, patient will have headache specifically locating to occipital region, which will be...
Headache will be one. Then?
If there is a hypertension, what are the symptoms? Simple thing.
Giddiness.
Rather than palpitation, patient may have giddiness.
Exactly. It will be a lot of giddiness, perspiration. What else?
So there will be this type of hypertension and symptoms of hypertension. In between, patient may have normal blood pressure. So if patient is going for checking of the blood pressure at that time, there may be hypertension, but after some time there may not be any hypertension.
Yes, ma'am.
Right? So patient may have giddiness because of this sudden hypertension.
Yes,
that is one thing. And this giddiness is usually related not with the systolic hypertension, it is related with the diastolic
hypertension.
If your patient is having pain and vomiting, only these two symptoms. As if the patient is having pain since 2 months and patient is having persistent vomiting or not able to take orally, adequate orally. Patient is taking orally because patient comes to you after 2 months, means patient might be taking orally, but yes, not adequate orally. So what could be the cause?
Ma'am, it could be chronic gastritis, could be severe reflux, GERD.
That is one. Okay, then.
Or patient may have gastric outlet obstruction.
Okay, second thought. Most common in our indoor patients. pain in vomiting with swelling. A patient is having pain, vomiting, and swelling of 2 months. What could be the commonest cause in our ward? Pseudopancreatic cyst. Now that should come in your mind. If there is a pain and vomiting, patient, and since 2 months only. So most of the time you may find out patient with pseudopancreatic cyst with swelling, right?
Okay. So moral of story is, do not take it for granted. You all are presenting case as if you are knowing the diagnosis. The principle of audit is there. How actually present patient present and what are the things you thought of. So it will not be most of that. What happens in our setup is that patient comes with diagnosis. Do you understand? We have already seen CT, USC. But that's why we keep audit. So every time that luxury is not there when you are in practice. You have to... What would be the symptoms when patient was not investigated? That is the important point. Keep all the possibility in your mind. It is not us that what happens, you have decided this is suprarenal and try to fit all the symptoms in suprarenal. Did you say the perspiration when you were saying paroxysmal hypertension?
Three cardinal signs of paroxysmal hypertension, paroxysmal perspiration. Mm-hmm. Headache and palpitation, sir.
Very good. So this should be your answer. One may be present, two may be present, but all three present, immediately you should suspect. What other thing you will ask in that condition? Suppose you are suspecting pheochromocytoma.
Episodic hypoglycemia?
Why there should be episodic hypoglycemia in pheochromocytoma? I have never
about seen. Pancreas. Are you thinking about pancreas?
I am saying pheochromocytoma, not neuroendocrine tumor. It's a totally different thing. The point is that why it is known as a paroxysmal.
Sir, patient may present on one day, but he may get the symptoms may get remitted, and again patient relapses after.
Okay, so it is not a continuous hypertension. Understand, in between patient will be normal. And second important point which you should ask, that's what audit is all about, clinical presentation. Trigger. What is trigger?
Sir, any specific location?
Any specific stimulation which will trigger the paroxysmal hypertension. A stimulation causing paroxysmal hypertension, hypoglycemia, hyperglycemia, mild touch, repeated coughing, increase in intra-abdominal pressure, direct trauma. So those, any of this can lead to patient developing paroxysmal hypertension. So when you go back and ask the patient, these are the things. Does the palpitation, perspiration appear after something or de novo? It can appear de novo, but that is an important point. So the next question is, it is always necessary to have a paroxysmal hypertension in a patient of pheochromocytoma?
No, sir. Patient can present in continuous pattern also, having persistent hypertension, which is resistant to calcium channel blockers or ARBs, which patient...
So, yes, very good. Excellent. So, paroxysmal is an important symptom, but not the only symptom. Understand? Patient can have a persistent, which word is used? Refractory hypertension. Very good. Anything else which my patient may present? No hypertension. A normotensive patient, can patient have a pheochromocytoma? Any third year
recently
who is there?
Recently you have said there may be a paroxysmal hypertension. So the in between when patient comes to you, it is normotensive patient. You are not noticing hypertension anything. Right?
So remember, some percentage of patient of pheochromocytoma had never had a hypertension. Understand? The 10% which is known as a asymptomatic patient. It is an accidental finding. You understand? So absence of hypertension does not rule out pheochromocytoma. Understand this point. It will be pronounced during surgery itself. So any patient not having hypertension and you are suspecting suprarenal, it is still mandatory that you should investigate for pheochromocytoma, right? We'll come to in this patient while unlikely to be a pheochromocytoma, but keep this thing in mind. Okay.
Sir, patient did not have any history of chronic weight loss, anorexia or weakness.
Very good.
Patient had weight gain of 3 kg in 2 months during the period in which we admitted the patient.
Okay.
And again admitted.
If it is a renal mass and patient is having gain of weight of 2 kg in 3 kg in 2 months, what could be the cause?
Chronic renal failure and having
load overload.
Edema.
Yes. Okay. Next.
There is some effect of that order, I think so today. I am happy. 46 participants are there.
Okay. Good.
Good. It should be minimum this much every time. Okay, continue.
Going on to past history, patient had past history of hypertension since 2008. Patient was on tablet metoprolol 50 milligram OD, tablet telmisartan 20.
Okay, continue. Patient, this is not a total history. Patient is known hypertension, taking antihypertensive drug. What is importance in drugs which is you should mention?
Sir, in this one drug is tablet metoprolol, which is beta blocker.
Very good.
And other than that, both of them are calcium channel blockers and androgen receptor blocker.
So what does it tell you?
Sir, patient was initially started on ARB, androgen receptor blocker and calcium channel blocker, but he was refractory to it. But then patient, when given tablet metoprolol, had some reduction in blood pressure, suggesting that patient may have this due to increased catecholamines.
Okay, possibility. It is a possibility. You should keep it in mind. Fine. But the important point is that patient is on hypertensive drugs since 12 years.
Yes.
Right? So it is unlikely to be pheochromocytoma. Keep this thing in mind. I'm not saying it will not be. But that is the what you should infer. Because
yes, patient requires 3 antihypertensive drugs. So any younger patient, particularly when they are having increased diastolic pressure most of the time and requires more antihypertensive, you should think about this patient may have pheochromocytoma. Okay. Next.
There was past history of angioplasty in 2008 due to myocardial infarction. Patient was on tablet aspirin anticoagulants for
yes, very good. And dabigatran. What is dabigatran?
Sir, direct thrombin inhibitor, sir.
Okay. So patient was on anticoagulant, right? What is important? What does it suggest?
Sir,
for our overall patient, it's a high-risk patient, you should understand, right? And it has some bearing on your surgery. We'll come to that later. Okay. Next.
Yes. On examination, on general examination, patient's pulse rate on presentation was 88 per minute and blood pressure was 168/90 millimeters of mercury. Mm-hmm. Rest of the general examination was normal. There was no pallor, icterus, sinusitis, clubbing.
Okay, got it.
Approximately 8 into 5 centimeter in abdominal examination, a lump was bimanually palpable and ballotable in left hypochondrium region, reaching up to left lumbar region, which was having smooth surface and was hard in consistency. It moves down with inspiration. There was no palpable notch and there was dull note over the lump on percussion. Rest of the abdominal examination was normal.
Okay. It is a 8x5 centimeter clinically palpable lump, right? Yes. The most important point I am interested is upper margin was palpable or not?
Sir, only lower margin was bimanually palpable. And
answer the question which I have asked.
No, sir, upper margin was not
palpable. Not palpable, right? So there is a possibility of spleen. Okay. And part of the lump was behind the rib cage. Yes. Agreed?
Yes.
Then how did you make this swelling palatable? How did you elicit palatability? Was this lump palatable?
Sir, yes, sir.
Is it written in the case paper that it was a palatable? What do you mean by palatable lump?
Sir, when we push a lump from the posterior surface, it gets palpable on the anterior surface by opposite hand, which we are.
And goes back. But what does it suggest? Agreed. Chalo, palatable lump you have elicited. What is the inference from that?
Sir, it could be renal.
No.
Retroperitoneal location of
the... No. Ovarian mass is also palatable. It is never retroperitoneal.
What does it suggest if it is a palatable swelling? Is having pedicle most of the time, but for uterus, it is fixed at the lower end and free at the upper end. So in uterus, it is only because of the fixity. But the rest of the palatable swellings are because of the pedicle.
Pedicle. So, do you think this lump had a pedicle?
No, sir.
So, the point was that it is a doubtable, but okay, we take it on your head. It is palatable. What does it mean to you?
Sir, it may be adhered to left kidney.
Not adherent to. If it is a palatable lump, I will think of kidney. Understand this point. Do you understand? A lump which is not from kidney will not be palatable because it becomes fixed. Kidney is confined within gerotas fascia and it hanging only on a perirenal pedicle. That's why in a benign large lump, it still becomes palatable. But a lump which is not from kidney is unlikely. Bimanually palpable is fine. That I agree with you. How do you do bimanual palpable? Because if you say palatable, I will put kidney as a first possibility. Understand this point. When you say bimanual, I put a retroperitoneal organ. Can be kidney, can be suprarenal, or a tail of pancreas and so on.
Was kidney palpable in this patient bimanually?
No, ma'am. There was one lump only which was palpable from...
It was of the shape of the kidney. Was it a shape of the kidney? Say, as you said, this was a palatable swelling in continuity with the kidney, then that should be a kidney-shaped swelling. With upper pole is little bit wider.
And upper pole should be palpable. That's why I ask. Any lump, when upper pole or upper margin is not palpable, doing a palatability is wrong. So what you say, it is palatable or not, it's doubtful. We cannot, but it was not palatable. It was bimanually palpable, right? Such a large swelling not arising from kidney or even it arising from kidney may not be palatable because it becomes fixed. And palatable is a very tricky answer. So if you are not very sure, avoid it. Bimanual, yes. How do you do bimanual palpation? Just sideways, I am asking you.
Sir. Swelling was on left side, so we will put our right hand below.
Okay, agreed. But what is the principal maneuver to do bimanual palpation?
We have to
Any third year there? I can see so many of them. Anybody hearing? Nobody wants to unmute. Should I give a name? Priya? Who are you, please?
Good evening, sir. Renav, sir.
Renav, yes. What is your answer? What is the important
thing? Sir, the upper hand will be, the hand which is on the anterior surface of abdomen will be kept fixed. While palpating.
No, both hands are kept fixed. One is parallel to rib cage and the posteriorly along the 12th rib just below. But the most important for bimanual palpation is you should ask for the patient to take a deep breath. The lump, if it is already palpable, will be palpated on both sides and pushes your hand out. Or if the lump is not palpable, when you ask the patient to take deep breath, it will come and touch your both hand and separate. So deep respiration, deep inspiration is mandatory. And that suggests the lump is in a continuation with diaphragm, so likely to come kidney or suprarenal. Do you understand? It does not mean it is retroperitoneal. It means it is retroperitoneal with attachment to the diaphragm. Understand this point. The spleen is not bimanually palpable because it's a positive on respiration intraperitoneal. That is a one more point to differentiate. But the important point is a two hands cap and ask the patient to take deep inspiration. The lump will separate your both finger. Whereas in a bellow table, you keep both hand like that, but you push with one hand by not allowing to do inspiration or expiration. That is a difference. The bellotability tells you about the free lump based on a pedicle. Renal lump will also be not bellotable when already touching on a both hand. The prerequisite for bellotomaline, it should be touching only one hand. The second hand will push it and make the lump appear on the opposite hand. That is the bellotability, which is common in a moderate to small swelling, not in a very large where it is already touching your both hand. Yes. So it is a bimanual. It suggests it's a retroperitoneal. You have already written, but did not speak. So Lakija moves downwards with this inspiration. Okay, next. Yes. So what was your first diagnosis from this? My friend, you cannot write down adrenocorticoid or pheochromocytoma. You should write down suprarenal mass. Yeah. Right? And renal cell carcinoma. Third, as Madam had said, a pseudocyst arising from tail of pancreas. Fourth is a sarcoma or similar retroperitoneal mass. Spindle cell is commoner in this area, should be kept in mind. So that it is not only three, there are four or five diagnoses from this, because it is a slow growing tumor, appears to be non-functioning, right? It does not, when you touch, did anything happen? No. And patient did not have a new symptoms. Hypertensive symptoms are since long. But as the patient is having a hypertension, angio was done, it suggests that it can still be a functioning tumor. So the suprarenal mass is the best way to say renal cell agreed, and don't forget retroperitoneal sarcomas. Because the history is short, it is in 2 months. Mm-hmm. You should keep that thing in mind.
More likely to be suprarenal than renal, as there was no history of persistent hematuria or other urinary symptoms.
That is the only reason it is not renal. Second is it is not bellotable. It is very large without any obstruction of any function. You understand? And second part is upper margin is not palpable. It is large tumor going behind the rib cage, both sides. So kidney tumor, even if they become large, you can insinuate your finger between rib cage and upper margin of lump, which was not here. So yes, but you cannot rule it out. So, but the first is a possibility of suprarenal sarcoma, renal cell carcinoma. Okay.
One more point. If you are saying renal cell, kidney tumor, then in that case, there is a band of resonance. Here you are saying it is a dull percussion. So if there is a kidney tumor, there is a band of resonance always there. If it is very large, then it is not present. It will shift the descending colon or the ascending colon medially, right? Okay.
More likely to be a medullary tumor due to complaints of headache, giddiness leading to...
So that is fine. You have put a differential diagnosis. We are considering it likely to be suprarenal mass or sarcoma. So what are the points in favor of suprarenal and what are the points in favor of sarcoma? We have ruled out renal cell unlikely, but still, yes, investigation can only tell. Yes. One is a patient is a headache, weight gain, and symptoms suggest might be a functioning tumor. Agreed. Anything for a sarcoma? Short history.
Sir has already said one point.
Very short history. Do you understand?
Short history with palpable tumor.
Palpable tumor should always be kept in mind. You understand? You have not mentioned anything about sarcoma. We were considering sarcoma as a possibility in this space. Particularly spindle cell tumors, which are formed to hard inconsistency, can present. That consistency is also another important point you should get. Harder the tumor, more likely to be sarcoma. Softer the tumor, likely to be suprarenal. But sarcoma cannot be ruled out, particularly when it is a retroperitoneal mass. May or may not be, that's a different thing. But you cannot take it for granted. The functioning, what you are suggesting, yes, it is a possibility, but you don't know what it can be. The weight gain of 3 kg is because of the patient was COVID positive and might be taking excessive nutrition.
One more thing, when there is a sarcoma, because of the patient is having increased vascularity in that area, sometimes those patients may have feverishness. Not fever, but it is a feverishness may be felt in spite of patient is in having malignancy in catabolic stage, may have feverishness. Okay.
Anybody? So, jate to koi kaise nahi. Priya? Girish, are you there?
Yes, sir.
Yes. So what are the symptoms if it is a functionally functioning adrenocorticoid tumor?
Sir, there may be puffiness and looks like Cushing syndrome, sir.
Yes, that's the very simple. You have already mentioned it later on. So you should keep it in mind. There will be a disproportionate weight gain. Second, it will be more of a fluid caloric retention rather than an actual weight gain. Buffalo hump, puffy moon face. Usually those are, because the adrenocortical tumors are usually have a symptoms due to corticosteroid, due to aldosterone and due to sex hormones. So hirsutism can also be one of the symptoms.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Somebody has asked about why this is not hydronephrosis. Though I know it is, but yes, he has raised the question, so we should discuss. Kaustubh?
Sir, palatability.
So we are, agreed, it is bimanually pulp, upper margin, not filled, not palatable, but yeah. 2 points should be kept in mind, bocillated swelling and soft swelling. Yeah. And third is absence of Dietl's crisis. These are the three points and no long history. So this should be kept in mind. It is a firm to hard swelling, upper margin not felt. There is no decrease in size of lump, no previous history of waxing and waning, and no Dietl's crisis. So reasonably, it is ruled out. If it would have been a little lower swelling, bocillated, because in case of gross hydronephrosis, such a large swelling, all upper, middle, lower calyxes will have a separate swelling like a bulging, which is very typical. And it may disappear after passing large amount of urine and reappear like that. And if it due to stone or any other condition, it will be a more chronic. We are talking of recent swell. Okay, next.
Sir, on admission, patient came with a USG abdomen pelvis report with key point being liver was normal, no free fluid in peritoneal cavity, and there was 13 into 12 centimeter large heterogeneous ecotextured lesion with internal vascularity, tiny foci of calcification was there, and it was possibly arising from left adrenal gland, as left adrenal gland was not separately visible, and it was abutting the superior pole of left kidney inferiorly and spleen superiorly.
Exactly. So what does it tell you? This USG, what does it tell you?
Sir, since it is kidney.
Okay, continue.
Sir, it suggests that since it is heterogeneously eco-textured lesion having internal vascularity, probably malignant lesion, sir.
Okay, again, one is that it is from whenever you describe this thing, it should always include two things. One is an organ diagnosis, second is a disease diagnosis. So what is your, so from USG, it was looking like left adrenal. So which is consistent with your clinical finding. It is a possibility, and it appears to, because of the description, it is a likely to be malignant. Agreed. These are the two things we also thought. So now what will you do before going to next? Next, what will you do? Will not do anything.
Sir, we will go for CECT abdomen.
So what are the reasons why straightway CECT abdomen?
Not any other blood investigation.
Ma'am, we should go for urine plasma.
Yeah, that is the question. Why do you want radiological investigation first rather than any blood investigation? Why? First thing is, it is
both can
costly.
Be...
if you are sending this radio, this blood investigation, it is costly. That is one thing. And by any way, this patient may require CT scan. So there will be a tissue diagnosis can be suspected that what could be the cause of adrenal tumor, or it is a something other than adrenal tumor that can be diagnosed. After that, you can send for this, right?
So
on the same day of admission, you can send patient for CCT, right?
There are two prongs. Looking at this, we need to establish two things. One, is it adrenal truly? If it is adrenal, what is the status of vascularity and relation with surrounding structure, especially kidney and blood supply, which cannot be said by US. So you need to do is,
see, we have to go.
Right. One. Second reason is that, so that will give you the idea about some operability and whether it is a malignant or benign. These two things, in good, it can say. Third, its relation with kidney and relation with renal vein. This is the important point, you should keep it in mind. When we are thinking of suprarenal, it is important. Sorry, Pilar. Cruzal no phone out, our laparotally chalama. Chalu rakham tam.
So what will you do now next?
Ma'am, we would go for CCT abdomen pelvis, and we can simultaneously go for plasma metanephrines and plasma salivary cortisol if the patient is admitted in the evening, or to look for Cushing syndrome. Or we can do it once the diagnosis is established. So, ma'am, in patient already had approached to us with a CCT abdomen pelvis report showing heterogeneously enhancing large lobulated lesion of 15.1 × 12 × 12.5 cm involving left adrenal gland with its mass effect causing displacement of left kidney inferiorly and spleen superiorly and pancreas anteriorly. There is no evidence of direct invasion of adjacent vital structures including abdominal aorta or renal vein. No retroperitoneal or mesenteric lymphadenopathy, and left lower ureteric and ancillary findings included left ureteric calculi with mild back pressure changes, but both the kidneys were excreting normally. There were multiple small gallbladder calculi. Sir, I am unable to hear you, sir.
Unmute Pankaj bhai. Unmute yourself.
Okay, sorry. What I want to say is that other things are fine. So what does the CECT show? The picture.
Yes.
Yes. Show the lump. Yes. So what now, the describe CECT finding.
Sir, it is a large heterogeneously ecotextured lesion with peripheral enhancements. It is abutting spleen superiorly and is also seen in this coronal plate displacing the left kidney downwards. The renal vein is also pushed downwards, sir.
Anything else you would like to see? Remember, as a surgeon, we are repeatedly saying we should be able to read this very properly. I was just only, madam, I was discussing there was a patient of a Cox abdomen, young female patient. CT was done. CT showed ileocecal tuberculosis. The looking at the patient's history, and there was no lump palpable, I said this patient is probably having multiple stricture, whatever the CECT people say. So nothing is perfect. So actually, that was the point. Per-operatively, there were 9 strictures. Ileocecal was normal. So there you can rely only up to certain extent. That's why I had to talk on the phone. The point here is, what are you seeing from your
most
point
important
of
important thing, whenever you are talking of adrenal tumor, which are the most important point?
Very important. I already said you something, but tell me, this is an important slide. I specifically told you, show this. You should be able to read and decide whole plan on this.
Sir, invasion into renal vein
is not seen. One, kidney is definitely separate. So there is no question of renal mass at this level. So that is the most important point you gain from the CECT. USG, most, you may... Yes?
Most important thing, it should not cross the midline.
Midline. That next point was...
Adrenal tumors do not cross the midline. It will not cross, even if it is bilateral.
So the point here is, see, the kidney is very well seen separately. It has a 2-3 significant. There might be exophytic growth arising from upper pole of left kidney. Do you understand? Which may, though unlikely such a large, but sometimes it may mimic it. So you can see in one of the picture where you have shown the arrow, large thick arrow, you can see the kidney lower down. Yes, that is absolutely, there is a normal area in between. That is an important point. And you can see the renal vein. Though it is there, it is very close to mass. That should be kept in mind. One more thing, it is on a left side. So what is significance? as far as the vascularity is concerned.
What will you see for first thing? In clinical examination, this much large tumor on the left side. What will you see for in clinical examination? Have you done that examination or not? In the scrotum, you have to see for the varicocele, right? Any tumor on the left side near the kidney, you should think about the varicocele.
Right? Yes. So that was a hint for you. What is the drainage on the left side for adrenal?
Sir, left adrenal vein drains into left renal vein.
Exactly. And exactly opposite it, there is a draining of the left in testicular vein. Patient was male. Now, do you understand why it is important to say sex of the patient?
Yes, sir.
That should be kept in mind. So here I would like to see, can you see the renal vein and its drainage, which is very much adherent. So that will be the one point you should keep it in mind. So the reading of USG is very, or CT is very important. Anything else about vascularity? Yes, yes, you are putting up arrow in the proper place. What does it show? This is also another one. Here you can see the spleen which is pushed. Can you see it in that arrow where you are showing arrow? You understand? The spleen is pushed. And what are you seeing on opposite side? Liver is normal, no metastasis. Don't forget to see that. Very important. Second point, higher up, pancreas is superior to it, but lump is again not related to or arising from pancreas as far as it is concerned. So it definitely suggests it's the left suprarenal. So now it is, you can investigate for the blood investigation, hormone here, because you have done all investigation and they are normal, and then later on you do CECT and it turned out to be sarcoma. So your whole investigation will be wasted. So organ diagnosis, if at all at some doubt, CECT should be done first, establish that it is an adrenal, then go for a whether it is a functioning or not. So keep this thing in mind, ultrasonography and CECT, right?
Yes.
There is going to be some discussion about MRI later on, but still it is a gold standard is CECT. It will show you everything. So from this, it looks like vascular left adrenal tumor. Now what?
Sir, now we should differentiate whether it is medullary tumor or...
Very good. You can do two things. One, what about function, and second about malignancy. Now these are the two points. What about malignancy? How will you establish the malignancy?
Sir, ideally, in this, there is already, there are internal ecotaxial and size is more than 6 cm, making it more than 50% likely to be adrenal carcinoma rather than a benign lesion. And second, sir, there is in CT, guiding it appears to be of more than 10. If we will go for NCCT abdomen and lesion comes to be more than 10 Hounsfield units, it is more likely to be malignant than benign lesion, sir.
So that is fine, agreed. But my question was, will you do biopsy any kind or not? This is important point to clarify.
No, sir.
Why not? Why not? Agreed. That is the important point. In a retroperitoneal adrenal or renal tumor, biopsy of any kind is not a mandatory thing. That's why the CT...
Why biopsy is not important?
Yes.
What is the treatment of choice in adrenal tumor and the renal tumor?
Ultimately, we will have to go for wide excision.
Either partial nephrectomy or total nephrectomy or adrenalectomy, right? So that is a treatment of choice. So tissue diagnosis is not important in that case.
Very, right? Yes. That's the point. You should understand at this stage. When you do
there are audit, specific indication for that, for tissue diagnosis, when it is inoperable or there is this lymph node, are there too much lymph nodes are enlarged, you are suspecting it, some metastasis, then tissue diagnosis is important. Otherwise, it is not required.
Yes, the point here is the report does not change your management. Right? The second point is many of these tumors are slow-growing tumor and they are low-grade malignancy. And CT, as you have said, Hounsfield will give you the rough idea. In a renal also, even if it's arising of one upper pole, you can safely do partial nephrectomy, even if it is a malignant. Do you understand? That's why the biopsy in renal and suprarenal are not that important. Right? So understand, USG...
Because it is a very vascular tumor.
Yes.
So if you do, then it requires emergency exploration.
And patient will have a... yes. So
FNSC
so
that, has no role. If you require, it requires to cut biopsy.
Yes. So keep this thing in mind when you are doing audit. Do not go for biopsy. Do not give biopsy that much importance unless, as Madam Hayes, there are some exception. So it brings to our function. Right? Remember, so how will you, what investigation you did next?
This was just about the incidence of...
Yes, you can very well say, fine, I saw that plate, yes. For our residents, a good thing, yes.
Sir, mostly adrenal, means if it is a functional tumor...
I would like to correct this. In pheochromocytoma, all 10. Right? So 11, rather than you can change to 10%, because it is a rule of 10 in pheochromocytoma. Right? Okay. Read it.
Ma'am, incidentally identified adrenal tumor on CT or USG finding will mostly 52% times come out to be a benign lesion and mostly adrenocortical adenoma.
And you don't need to do anything for that.
Yes.
You just follow up the patient. Yes. So 50% of adrenal tumor less than 4 or 5 centimeter, you wait and watch.
Yes. And if it is more than 4 centimeter, 25% of times it comes out to be adrenocortical carcinoma. And in overall population, it is approximately 12%.
Very good.
Pheochromocytoma, as ma'am said, 10%. And in myelolipoma, 8%. Adrenal cyst, simple benign adrenal cyst, 5%. Metastasis, 2%. And miscellaneous.
Okay. From where does the metastasis come? Renal? Or a John C. You are the person you should be answering. From where does the metastasis of adrenal come?
Sir, CA lung.
Because of the recent patient.
Because recent we have.
That's why, because I saw that patient. Anywhere, anything else?
And so from anywhere? Renal, from
yes.
Renal carcinoma?
Yes. It can be a local metastasis because of the direct venous spread. Anything else? Liver. Always keep liver in mind. Hepatocellular CA can go to adrenal also. From adrenal, where the metastasis will go? Kaustubh?
Sir, it travels along IVC, so liver would be most and renal.
There is a good picture into the low belly.
You should go and...
Recently. You should go and read. From the right side, it is different. On the left side, it is different.
Because of as I goes, when you should keep it in mind. So you should go and read that. You should have put that picture also. I think it is not there. Yene mane hamnaj mokliyo etle marathi thodu jovayu chhe etle khabar. Okay, anyway. But please go and read it.
Read it. Okay.
Right. Next.
What next?
Remember, you, my friend, this is not incidental tumor. Forget about it. When it is a 15 centimeter tumor, you cannot call it. It was not accidentally found. Incidental tumor is usually when you have investigated for something else and you find there is an adrenal tumor, you treat like this. Here, there is no question of incidental tumor. You cannot leave it alone. The word incidental tumor is there because in a 50% of tumor, you can keep them conservatively and simply observation. Same thing goes for a renal tumor also, but not this one. Any tumor more than 4-5 centimeter and symptomatic. Size, pain is a symptom. So you cannot call incidental tumor. Do not confuse all adrenal or incidental. So this is not a proper thing.
And here the patient has told that he was able to palpate the swelling.
So it is not incidental tumor. Right? So just scratch it, scrap it, next. It's not perfect. Because you are the CT comes last, which is not there. Now what if? The point is that you have done CECT. The next is, we have already discussed function. So how will you investigate for a function?
Sir, in functional tumors, if it is, if we are considering pheochromocytoma,
we will have... beta, there is not if. This is audit. It is not if. This is the patient. No ifs.
Sir, we have to go for serum electrolytes to look for hypokalemia.
Very good.
The sign of Cushing syndrome. Then serum VMA, vanillin mandelic acid. It is a metabolite of catecholamine. So serum
urinary VMA is also done.
Yes, ma'am. Serum VMA is considered more sensitive than...
More sensitive, but urinary VMA is also done. You should keep in mind. Okay. Yeah.
And so we have to combine it with urinary metanephrine to increase the specificity of the test because of large number of false positives in both individually in serum VMA and urinary metanephrine.
Okay.
And low-dose dexamethasone suppression test is a screening test, provocative screening test for Cushing syndrome. But nowadays, it is not used.
You can directly go for serum cortisol level.
Serum cortisol, salivary cortisol or urinary free cortisol.
Okay. So the point here is you have to investigate for two things. One, whether it is a medullary functioning tumor or cortical functioning tumor. Looking at your history, what were you suspecting? What is more likely? This is not, at least I am not concerned.
Sir, patient had refractory.
Yes, exactly. So I was thinking in term of pheochromocytoma, right? Point against it was a too large a tumor to be a asymptomatic pheochromocytoma. But patient had a hypertension. Do you understand? So first thing I would do the frequent checking of blood pressure every 4 hourly in a ward. Especially look for a paroxysmal hypertension retrograde. Initially you may not have done, but once the CECT suggests it can be a pheochromocytoma. I don't know. So I would like to see whether it is a paroxysmal attack is that. And I would investigate first for that also. Because on other hand, even cortical, you can see, even if it is a cortical, it is non-functioning tumor. Because patient doesn't have any symptoms and sign which suggests there is a hypercortisol. Do you understand? Yes. There is no evidence of
hypercortisol, Cushing's.
Yes. So this thing should be kept in mind. Continue.
Screened for pheochromocytoma by urinary vanillin mandelic acid, which was normal, and plasma metanephrine, which was also normal. Patient was hypertensive with some control with beta blocker, calcium channel blockers and ARBs, with average systolic BP by diastolic BP of 160 mmHg for 110 mmHg. Since pulse pressure is approximately only 50 millimeters, is 50 millimeters of mercury, it appears to be in normal range. In pheochromocytoma, usually pulse pressure is widened.
Okay. So what do you want to say from this?
Sir, pheochromocytoma is unlikely.
Okay. Agreed. Okay. You are not thinking of pheochromocytoma, right? So that is the one thing. You are thinking of adrenal cortical tumor, right? Anything else you were thinking, which I was actually thinking. Okay. This is for all the PGs to keep in mind. A 15 centimeter size arising from adrenal having non-function is mostly malignant. Keep this thing in mind. Do you understand? If it is a functioning, patient would have come much earlier with symptoms of increased cortisol or increased metanephrine. You understand? And when patient has come this late, and this is an inadrenal corticoid tumor, if it is malignancy, most of the time they are low-grade malignancy. Keep this thing in mind. Because it has increased such a large tumor, still all planes are preserved. You understand?
Show your CT. Show your CT.
Yes, you can see that.
So it is not a homogeneous mass. It is variegated. So it's some area there is a cystic, some is having heterogenic, some is having hypoechoic. So you should think about malignancy.
Malignancy is always on the card. So we go further now. So remember, here looking for a cortisol is okay, but it's not important. But it is very important to look for a pheochromocytoma. Why?
Because we cannot directly it's take 6 o'clock. Patient for OT in, there is a lot of pre-operative planning to be done before pheochromocytoma. We have to give alpha blockade for 5 days, and then we will have to again one day before operating go for beta blockade and to prevent intraoperative hypertension and also postoperative hypertension.
So there are different studies. Few studies says you can operate within 6 days or 7 days of this type of shot given alpha and beta blockage. Few says that you should give it at least for 15 days alpha blocker if hypertension is there. Yes. It is a functioning tumor. Then you give prazosin for initially started with 5 milligram. That can be increased up to the 10 milligram. And then you add the, after 1 week, you add the beta blocker. You will not start with directly with the beta blocker in those.
Why?
Sir, if you, there will be unopposed action of alpha norepinephrine.
You cannot. Usually you should start first alpha blocker and then beta blocker. Why?
Sir, if you will give beta blocker first, there will be unopposed action of alpha receptors on peripheral vasculature, leading to unopposed.
And what word for that? Rebound hypertension. There will be a rebound hypertension. So initially, when you start for 1 or 2 days, there may be reduction in blood pressure, and then there is a sudden shoot up of blood pressure. So initially, it is started with alpha blocker, then beta blocker, right?
Low dose dexamethasone suppression test with advent of the measurement of salivary and urinary cortisol, this test has fallen out of use. Cutoff value for salivary cortisol for Cushing syndrome should be done in evening only, as lowest or nadir of cortisol level in serum.
It is nadir, N-A-D-I-R.
Yes.
Lowest point.
Comes in the evening. So if it is more than 550 nanogram per milliliter in evening, then it is more likely to be Cushing syndrome. And 24-hour urinary cortisol should be done 2 times 24-hour apart. And usually when they both come elevated for more than 3 times the upper normal unit, it is suggestive of... Sorry.
What happened? Okay, the point what I want to say is, did you do any of this?
No, sir.
So it is not part of audit. The audit part is why you did not do this.
Sir, there was no sign and symptoms suggestive of Cushing.
Exactly. Yes. So that is the point. Here I want to say, though it was an adrenal corticoid tumor, we were suspecting a possibility with pheochromocytoma. But patient did not have anything which suggests increased level of steroid. So even if you do it, it is not going to be conclusive and it is a costly affair. So the point I want to say, it is not mandatory to do these tests. Where a test for pheochromocytoma, we do VMA and metanephrine because it is going to change, because the many patients are asymptomatic. Or patient is not having a paroxysmal hypertension. And at the time of surgery, it is going to create a problem. Where even if it is a functioning corticoid tumor, it is not going to change your management. That's why when you see adrenal, we extensively investigate for pheochromocytoma, but not extensively for corticoid tumors. You understand? And adrenocorticoid, most of them are not functioning. Usually it comes from some other places like a odd cell carcinoma, NET or something like that. So adrenal cortical tumor on its own, most of them, once they gain beyond 7-8 centimeters, are likely to be low-grade malignancy and they are non-functional. So in this patient, we did investigation for 24-hour VMA and metanephrine, but not for a steroid. Keep that in mind. If the patient had a Cushing or similar, which suggests increase, then only there is a role of doing it, which is rarely, rarely required. The point here is a similar Cushing-like effect can be there in a patient who has insulinoma. So in those cases, it's a different thing. But most of the time, adrenal tumor itself, we do not investigate for corticoid tumor biochemical mark. Okay. So this was not done. Now next, from clinical judgment and investigation, it looks like non-functioning adrenal tumor. Agreed? So what is the next thing?
Sir, options could be surgery for left adrenalectomy, wait and follow up with CCT 6 monthly, but it is
wait and follow up in this patient.
No audit here very clearly surgery.
The only point of the things comes if it is a smaller tumor.
But one thing you have mentioned that I would like to discuss, there is no Cushing, so no marginal adrenalectomy. The point is FDG scan should be done or not. What is your take? We did not do it, but should it be done or not?
Sir, again, it won't change our management.
So what is the role of FDG PET?
Sir, it is to differentiate benign from malignant lesion, mm-hmm. as well as to look for, in a whole body manner, to look for any metastasis.
Very good. So why it doesn't make any difference here? You should understand, this question can be asked in exam. Yes? So the
as
point
in here, our patient, as was as in our patient, if there is a one focus is seen into the lung, right? And after doing the adrenalectomy, this disappears. Then it confirms that it was a metastasis from the adrenal gate.
Remember,
the
point here is even if it is a metastasis from adrenal, it is mandatory that you should do adrenalectomy. Many metastases disappear after adrenalectomy. So if at all PET scan is to be done, it is to be done after adrenalectomy. That should be kept in mind. So at present, there is only one option, and it was obvious looking at the mass and all thing, is a surgery. There is no other option. All three options are not for now. Do you understand? Even if it is a functional Cushing syndrome, still patient can have a malignancy. So there is no conservative treatment absolutely in this patient. This all will come follow-up CECP when it is less than 4 centimeters in size. This is not a general, it's about this case. The only point is the whether open adrenalectomy or laparoscopic.
Sir, considering its size and also that the we are pretty much sure that it is malignancy, we should go for open.
No, the point is size. Size.
Size matters, not the malignancy or non-malignancy.
But you should keep this thing in mind. People do laparoscopic retroperitoneal. So that is an option one should keep in mind. Don't just say it is not possible, but with looking at the size, associated medical condition and patient side, it is preferred to do open. But laparoscopy should be kept in mind. If it would have been a pheochromocytoma and less than 10 centimeter, laparoscopy is preferred over this. Okay, continue. Next.
Intraoperative finding, we did exploratory laparotomy. Liver was normal. There was no ascites. Metox maneuver was performed.
No, sir. Just tell me. I don't want step. There is no role of steps in audit. What incision you put? That you are not mentioned, which is most important. So you don't know what incision was put and you have prepared the slides.
No, sir. midline incision from
So these are the small point which will make you a trouble. Understand this point. It was a midline incision. What I want to discuss is why midline incision and no other incision. What are the other incision we could have put? That is our audit. This Mattox maneuver is not our audit.
Left subcostal incision or...
So why we did not put a left subcostal incision?
Sir, there would be better exposure in because tumor was very large and...
Okay. Because this point is very important. Madam said one thing, you know that? Adrenal tumor never crossed the midline.
Never crossed.
So you can put a left subcostal or right subcostal. So why it was not put? That is our audit. Mattox maneuver, it is a standard procedure. All other things are standard. You cannot have an audit. Why you tackle Levain first, last? It is not like that. If per as the, it comes like that. The important point is size is very large. Second point is that we would like to specifically approach and control the renal vein. Do you understand? And remember, wherever may be the kidney, wherever may be the suprarenal, renal vein is easily approachable near midline. Second point, when the tumor is becoming larger, it will, adrenal tumor will push the renal vein down.
Onward.
You understand? So it is easily approachable by midline incision. So that point should be kept in mind that midline is a preferred incision in malignancy, whether it is a renal or whether it is a adrenal. Subcostal incision is put if the tumor is less than 5 cm or 6 cm, particularly pheochromocyto. Please continue. Yes.
Sir, left adrenal vein was draining into left renal vein, and left adrenal vein was identified ligated and cut, and left renal vein was safeguarded. Multiple feeder vessels were present from posterior surface of pancreas to the mass, which were cauterized using bipolar cautery. So
one
there
thing
was
left,
one between...
thing left, there is also a vessels arising from the this diaphragm. Diaphragmatic vessel is always there. That is to be also controlled. Okay.
Mass was adherent to peritoneum. There were multiple adhesions which had to be. So we placed only one single abdominal drain of 32 number size in left paracolic gutter while closure and then closed. And these are the intraoperative per operative photos of this patient. As we can see, it is a 16x14 cm of mass and it is displacing spleen superiorly. And here ma'am, we can see left adrenal vein arising from left renal vein. And also the inferiorly displaced left renal vein, this is after the specimen has been resected. And last picture showing inferior surface of the tumor, which is completely separated from kidney. There was no...
So fat plane was preserved between the kidney and
kidney
the
and the tumor.
Okay.
I'm moving on. Post-operative course, patient was shifted to ICU for monitoring. Patient had intraoperative episodes of irregular cardiac rhythm. Patient had similar irregular cardiac rhythm for 2 days post-operatively, during which average pulse rate was 102 per minute. Immediately, urgent cardio reference was
done.
So
what was the irregular cardiac rhythm?
Ma'am, it was sinus rhythm. It was not sinus rhythm, but there were no changes in the ECG other than irregular pulsations.
Okay.
So cardiology reference was done. So they told that if the rate would be controlled, then automatically everything would be controlled. So they gave tablet metoprolol for both rate control and to give rest to cardiac muscle.
Any patient who is having cardiac ischemia, myocardial ischemia, should be on the beta blocker, because one is rate control is important. So whenever there is a tachycardia, that tachycardia also lead to the other
complications. Arrhythmias. And
so beta blocker is must in those patients.
Okay. So tablet metoprolol was started as beta blocker at 25 milligram BD. Intraoperatively
after second day, it was started after second day. Till that,
on second day, ma'am, on second day it was started.
Before that, how the blood pressure was controlled?
Injectable labetalol was given, ma'am, in infusion rate of. Sorry, ma'am, I don't remember.
Was it given 8 hourly or BD?
Ma'am, BD.
How much it required?
Ma'am, it was given BD only. BD. Because okay. Patient had systolic blood pressure of only 140/90 throughout the post-op course. There was no sudden hypertension or for this patient. Only irregular rhythm with tachycardia was there.
Okay. If there is any T changes, either it is a T inversion or ST elevation, then anti-jittery is also required in those post-op. Right.
So, one more question, Kaustubh.
Yes.
So, what was the preoperative preparation that you have just skipped?
Sir, since it was a large tumor,
Everybody knows large tumor, but fine, audit. But what did you prepare? People will ask you. Did you keep blood ready?
Yes, sir. We kept ready 2 pints.
How much pint? Important. This is extra major surgery, minimum 3.
3 is minimum. There is no role of 1 or even 2. 3 is minimum. Right? Anything else?
We kept ICU cot ready for this patient.
Arre, that is great. What else? Did you take a consent of nephrectomy?
Yes, sir. We took consent of
nephrectomy
or splenectomy.
Yes. So, yes, we did. You have forgotten to mention. So, why it is necessary?
Sir, intraoperatively, if there was invasion into...
So, you said there is a stretching of the renal vein. So, it is likely it may get injured also.
Yes, ma'am.
It may be involved or it may get injured.
So sometimes you should be ready to for a vascular clamp as well as a vascular surgeon, because injury to renal vein doesn't mean nephrectomy unless it is completely engulfed. You can always replace with the graft, should be kept in mind. That should be in your mind also, as well as splenectomy is also necessary. I was actually for an important one more question I wanted to ask. Are there any other approach apart from midline and subcostal? That you should have read. We did discuss when you said that what, because there are other approach depends upon the CECT. The CECT was clearly suggesting that it was relatively free. Only worry was renal vein, and which is best tackled by midline incision. But there are incision like you can put a Morris incision, that is a flank incision like in kidney,
yes.
Rib cutting. You can put a Nagamatsu incision that is going higher up, and you can put a thoracoabdominal diaphragm cutting incision, which will remain retroperitoneal and retropleural. We used to put this incision, which was either 8th or 9th rib cutting, preferably 9th rib cutting. That will go posteriorly, patient is put in a lateral position. Those are useful when the tumor are very much adherent posteriorly and you get direct approach to them. But these are now visually big, but in a circumstances like a very large tumor, you should also think of such incision.
So midline incision is extended laterally on the thorax through the costochondral junction, and then it is extended upwards and then diaphragm is cut in that
case. That is a different incision. What I am talking is a patient is put in a flank position, an oblique incision like a spine approach is put from lateral border of rectus at the level of umbilicus to the incision will go along the axis of 8th or 9th rib up to root of rib, and the rib is cut along with the part of the diaphragm is cut laterally. Those are the incision, you should keep it in mind. Though it is rarely put, we have put a quite a few number. We used to put this incision in a pheochromocytoma to get the early control of vessel. But the with advent of laparoscopy, it is always preferred. Okay. Next. I think anything else you would like to discuss? I think it is, patient is fine.
Enough.
Yes, sir. Patient histopathology report.
Yes, that is an important point I wanted to, yes. Yes. So what is histopathology?
Sir, it was well-encapsulated tumor containing large pleomorphic cells, abundant pale eosinophilic and vacuolated cytoplasm, arranged in sheet-like pattern, and marked nuclear anaplasia with scattered atypical mitosis, finding which was suggestive of low-grade adrenocortical carcinoma with TNM stage of T2 and no nodal and metastasis not assessed.
Okay. So what does it mean now? From histopatho.
So large tumors can still be low grade adrenocortical carcinoma, so we should go for surgery.
Early surgery is useful, one. And most of the tumor, once removed, low grade malignancy does not require any further treatment. Third, adrenal cortical tumor, even when they are very large and potential of malignancy, rarely invade other structure. This thing you should keep in mind. We have operated up to 20 centimeter of adrenal cortical tumor, but without any invasion. So capsule is well maintained in most of these cortical tumors, right? So surgical excision is the gold standard and you should always attain that. The renal reason for nephrectomy or splenectomy consent is only for a vascular point of view. There might be irreparable injury or that. Otherwise, most of the time, you are able to save the kidney. Okay. Done?
Yes, sir.
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you. It was good. Okay.
Okay.